You know, you can win over your experience with bitterness. Maybe you don't go to church anymore because you've suffered hurt in the church. And there are a lot of people who go through that. Because after all, hey, church is filled with human beings just like you, just like me. We hurt each other. We do each other wrong. We say the wrong thing. We do some really nasty things sometimes in life, even though we are Christians. And I've met people who said, well, Pastor Tony, I'll go to church when I find the perfect church. And I'll tell them, oh, dear one, don't do that, because as soon as you join that perfect church, it won't be perfect anymore. Let me tell you something. Ain't no perfect churches. There's only a perfect Savior. There's only a perfect God.
Welcome to Unchurched with Evangelist Anthony Sluzas. If you or someone you know has been away from the church, this podcast is for you. We hope you are encouraged by this practical and Christ-centered message today. If you'd like more information about Your Place of Grace Ministries and our resources, visit yourplaceofgrace.com.
You're listening to Unchurched, and this is Anthony Sluzas. I'm so glad you're tuning in today to our little podcast. This podcast, again, is new, and it's really aimed toward people who, for whatever the reason, no longer attend church. And today I want to talk about bitterness. Yeah, bitterness. That's one reason people don't attend church anymore. The question is, are you getting bitter or are you getting better? See, one of the most effective tools against sincere Christians is the tool of bitterness. I don't really recall the very first experience I ever had with like a satanic attack of bitterness, but I've had enough throughout the years of these attacks and temptations to be bitter that I feel pretty qualified to speak about it. I want to tell you a story. Years and years ago, a young preacher knelt beside an elderly man of God, a preacher, during a time of prayer. When the younger man started talking to the older preacher about his soul, he looked up at the younger preacher with an attitude of condescension. He said, "Son, don't hand me those cliches. I've preached three times more than you have, and three times more than other people. I know all those scriptures that you're quoting to me. I simply can't get right with God. I'm past feeling." Now, when the older preacher said that, the younger one felt crushed, and he looked at the elderly preacher with compassion. He didn't recognize it at the time, but he was dying with a broken heart and a spirit of bitterness. And the elderly preacher then explained, some preachers had failed to stand by him during an attack upon his character. His wife had deserted him for another man. His children never phoned him. He felt even church members were too busy gossiping to spend time helping an ex-preacher who willingly became a servant to bitterness. Can I tell you something right now, my friend? Bitterness will make you a slave. Bitterness will kill your spirit. Yes, bitterness will wipe the smile off your face and will sap and drain the river of blessing from your soul. Bitterness will paralyze your effectiveness for God. And you must master bitterness, or it will master you. It happens to teenagers who
trust someone and are betrayed. It happens to parents who do all they know to do and still their children quit going to church. It happens to wives who try to follow the scriptural pattern to lead their husbands to the Lord while they refuse to acknowledge the truth. Years ago, by the time I had resigned my last church, I pastored for 16 years, a couple of different churches. And when I resigned my last church back in 2010, when the Lord called me to go out onto the field to be a traveling evangelist, well, back in 2010, I was almost gripped with bitterness. Some very difficult things had happened during the years of my pastorate. Don't get me wrong, there were wonderful times of pastoring. I loved it. I really did. But we had some really rough patches, and I know all pastors do. And when I resigned the pastorate in 2010, I remember my daughter way back at that time coming up to me and saying, "Dad, I'm really glad you resigned." I said, "Really? Why?" And my daughter responded, "I just didn't like the way those people treated you and Mom." Wow. It affected my daughter in a adverse way. I'll never forget that. And even when I went on the road to preach as an evangelist, and I'm still doing that now, I'm going on 25 years in full-time ministry. But when I started out preaching on the road, I was almost done in through bitterness. I was terribly tempted to become bitter. I had preached for several ministers who I thought were friends and several pretty substantial offerings were given during my meetings in several churches. And the fact of the matter is, the pastors of those several churches held back some of the offerings that were due me. I couldn't believe it. I would expect this in the secular world, in the business world, but in a church? They're holding back some of my offerings to keep for themselves? Oh, was I tempted to become bitter? Absolutely. And it started to affect me in a very adverse way. I was becoming impatient, short-tempered. And I was becoming short-tempered with people that I loved, my own family. I was beginning to lose my desire for the Word of God. I hit a point where I didn't want to pray. And yet I was still attempting to minister each night in these meetings while harboring the seeds of bitterness in my spirit. But thank God there finally came a point when the Holy Spirit dealt with me lovingly but very strongly that I needed to pray. And that I needed to forgive, even as I had been forgiven at the cross of Calvary. Ooh, that was hard. But you know, the words came to me, and I believe the Holy Spirit spoke them into my heart at the time. The words were, "Son, you will never have to forgive anyone more than I have already forgiven you." Whew. Wow. Those were the words of Jesus being spoken into my heart. "Son, you'll never have to forgive anyone more than I have already forgiven you from the cross." Wow, praise God. You know, you can win over your experience with bitterness. Yeah, maybe you don't go to church anymore because you've suffered hurt in a church. And there are a lot of people who go through that. Because after all, hey, church is filled with human beings just like you, just like me. We hurt each other. We do each other wrong. We say the wrong thing. We do some really nasty things sometimes in life, even though we are Christians. And I've met people who said, well, Pastor Tony, I'll go to church when I find the perfect church. And I'll tell them, oh, dear one, don't do that, because as soon as you join that perfect church, it won't be perfect anymore. Let me tell you something. Ain't no perfect churches. There's only a perfect Savior. There's only a perfect God. And the church is filled with imperfect people who need that Savior and who need each other. Loved one, again, the old saying goes, no man is an island. No. We need each other. And we need our Savior Jesus Christ desperately. You can win over your experience with bitterness, no matter what's happened to you, no matter how badly you've been hurt, maybe by church people, maybe by a church, maybe by a pastor. You can overcome your experience with bitterness. You can overcome your experience with bitterness that may have come through a divorce or a sickness, the loss of a friend, the death of a child, a financial setback. Loved one, regardless of what happens to you, make up your mind to overcome it in the power of God. First of all, admit that you are living with the root of bitterness in your heart. Admit it. Admit it before God and to yourself. Don't lie to yourself. Be real. Secondly, admit that it is wrong and it's damaging you physically, spiritually, psychologically. Thirdly, admit your own mistakes. Admit your sin and confess it. Fourth, look for the lessons that the Holy Spirit wants to teach you. Yes, He wants to teach you some very valuable lessons through this difficult time you're going through. Fifth, do not talk your bitterness to other people. No. Big mistake. Keep it between you and God. Number six, stay in harmony with godly friends. Get away from ungodly gossips. Stay away from people who are just miserable and negative all the time, unbelieving. Stay away from them. Stay in harmony with godly friends. Number seven, soak your soul in the Scriptures, preferably the Psalms of David, as he cried out to the Lord in his most difficult and bitter times. Number eight, plan new projects for your future. Yes, look forward. Don't look behind you. Look forward to the future. Plan new projects. Follow new dreams. Oh, loved one, think about it. When you're driving in your vehicle on the highways, on the streets, if you're constantly focused on your rearview mirror, you're in for a crash. You're in for a deadly crash. And it's the same in life. Focus on the road before you, not on what's happened behind you. Follow God's plan for your life. Number nine, think ahead and not backward. Again, same thing. Think ahead, not backward. Number 10, discuss everything with the Holy Spirit. And bitterness will literally be choked out and displaced as you place your trust in God and talk to and listen to the still small voice of His Holy Spirit. Number 11, study winners in the Bible. Yeah, study the real winners in the Bible, those who won over bitterness, like Joseph, for instance. Like Joseph toward his own brothers. Study winners in the Bible, those who won over bitterness. And loved one, I'm going to close with this. Never, never, never allow the root of bitterness to rob you of the success and joy that God wants you to experience in life. Praise God. Finally, if you're not attending a church right now, for whatever the reason, again, maybe you've been hurt. Maybe something terrible happened. Maybe there was a church split and it scared you away from church. Or maybe you've just never even wanted to go to church in the first place. Oh, my friend, we need each other. Get involved in a good church family. Hey, it's true. No church is perfect. And you're not perfect. I'm not perfect. But the Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews, do not forsake the assembling of yourselves together, as is the habit of some. I don't want to be a part of those some, do you? No. So pray about it. Ask God where He would want you to attend church. And go check out a few different churches. Go this weekend. And when you find that just that right church, get plugged in. Don't be scared. Don't be nervous or intimidated. Get plugged in. Meet with the pastor. Have lunch or breakfast with him. Get involved. Be a blessing, okay? Don't always look to be blessed. You be a blessing. Today we're spotlighting a really, really wonderful church that's pastored by another wonderful friend of mine. This church is in Springfield, Oregon. And I've preached there several times over the years. And the church is named New Life Church in Springfield, Oregon. Right next door to Eugene, right next door to University of Oregon. Go Ducks! New Life Church is pastored by a dear friend of mine, Pastor Todd Wagner. And his son Brent is also pastoring that church. And Brent and Todd both have wonderful families. And the New Life Church family is a wonderful group of people. And every time I go there, I'm more blessed by them than they are by anything that I could say or do. What a wonderful church family. So if you live in the Springfield or Eugene, Oregon areas, please do visit New Life Church and say hello to Pastor Todd and Pastor Brent for me and tell them Tony sent you. I know you're going to be blessed. It's a vibrant church. They're impacting the Springfield and Eugene communities in powerful ways. They have a wonderful missions program. They also do so much for the community. And please check out their website. It's nlcchurch.com. That's nlcchurch.com. Thank you for listening today. And let me pray with you as we close. I have a sense that maybe somebody's listening today that you've never made Jesus Christ Lord of your life. And yet there are others of you that are listening today who once knew Jesus, who once were involved in church, but you feel now, Tony, I need to recommit my life to Christ. Well, you can do that right now too. So for those of you who don't know Jesus Christ as Lord, and for those of you who do but have strayed and drifted away, let's pray this together. And repeat after me right now. Pray it with all your heart. Dear God in heaven, Yes, say it with me. Dear God in heaven, I come to you in the name of Jesus Christ. Oh, please forgive me for the way I've lived, for the things I've done, and cleanse me with your precious blood from all my sin and unrighteousness. Right now, with my mouth, I confess the Lord Jesus. In my heart, I believe that God raised Jesus from the dead and he is alive. This very moment, I accept Jesus Christ as the Savior of my soul, and I make him the Lord of my life. And according to God's word, which cannot lie, I am washed, I'm cleansed, I am forgiven, I am healed, and I am reborn. In Jesus' powerful and wonderful name I pray, amen and amen. Praise God, praise God. Thank you for listening. Hey, thank you for listening to Unchurched. And let me tell you, let me encourage you, don't be unchurched anymore. All right? Get plugged in. Again, if you live in the Springfield, Oregon area, go visit New Life Church and tell Pastor Todd Tony sent you. Or wherever you live in this nation or around the world, go to church next weekend. Become part of the family of God. Be a blessing. Okay? All right. God bless you. And until next time, have a wonderful and mega blessed day. See you next time on Unchurched.
Thank you for listening to Unchurched. We hope our podcast was a blessing to you today by encouraging you and calling you back to Jesus and home to his church. If you'd like more information about our ministry, go to yourplaceofgrace.com.